Hi, I'm Paul, the CEO and co-founder of Supabase. Today, I'm going to cover everything that you need to know about Postgres row level security. I'll cover how to use Postgres row level security, why you might want to use it, and some neat performance tricks. Let's get into it. So, as I mentioned, we're going to cover in this talk everything you need to know about Postgres row level security. I've got a handy table of contents down the bottom, so if you're watching this in video format, you can just skip ahead. First of all, who am I? My name's Paul Copplestone. I'm the CEO and co-founder of a company called Supabase. What is Supabase? We are a Postgres hosting company. And if you use us or if you're familiar with us, you'll know that we also host a bunch of tools that make it really easy to use Postgres. In particular, there is a tool called Postgres, which is a really cool open source project, and it helps you to serve a RESTful API on top of any Postgres database by automatically translating the database schema into a RESTful API. Postgres leverages Postgres very heavily, including the role system and row level security. And this is the reason why we have become very familiar at Supabase with row level security and have a few sort of insights over the past 4 years. We are also an open source company, and we've now hosted and launched over 1 million Postgres databases. So let's get into, before I get into it, just a trigger warning, I use some lowercase SQL in this. That's largely because of the profile of customer that we were targeting in the early days was not so much of a database developer, so we decided to consolidate on lowercase to make it more approachable. So if you like uppercase SQL, I'm sorry. Okay, so what is row-level security? You can think of it as really authorization for Postgres. And auth comes in two flavors, both authentication and authorization. And authentication tries to answer the question, is a user or role allowed to access a database? And then if that is true and they are allowed to access the database, authorization answers the question, now that they're in, what specifically are they allowed to access? And in this case, with Postgres, you can write some SQL function that can determine either a true or a false around certain sets of data that a user can access. I actually usually explain this to developers, or at least this helped me in the early days, was by using this mental model that row-level security is an implicit where clause for your queries. For example, let's say that we are selecting from a profiles table where I'm actually only allowed to see my own profile. In this case, I have forgotten to put a where clause in. So ideally, I would have this this security clause, which specified that me, user 1234, is only allowed to access this. And so this is what Postgres row level security is. You can attach a policy. I've got a very simple example, which I'll go through in a second. But the main thing that you need to know is that this where clause essentially is this policy is essentially giving us this sort of where clause filtering. This means that if a user, in this case, user ID 1337, tries to access the profiles table and they don't actually have access to any particular row, then the RLS policy will get assessed for the profiles table. And because it does not return true in this clause, then they will essentially return an empty data set. So why would you use row-level security? There are numerous reasons. The most obvious, of course, is security. And in security, there's a concept called defense at depth. And this really means that you add multiple layers in terms of your security. So you might have security at your front end, inside your application, your API, your middleware, all the way down to your database. The reason why I really like it at the database level is that it increases your default security posture in that everything that's built, typically a Postgres database is kind of the bottom of the stack, and so that every application on top of the database will at least have the default security model of your database. So we think it's really important to put some data security at the database level, and then any tool which is accessing the data will at least take that security posture. The second reason is that you might increase performance in some cases. So in this case, typically what happens with an application is that it has to make, on the left-hand side, two requests to two different services. So an app might first make an auth request to an auth service, and that will validate that a user is allowed to log in and get their permissions. And then it might make a second request to your database to get the data itself. Now, if you can bundle that all into a single paradigm, then you essentially cut down one whole network request. So if you use it in that way, it's actually extremely fast. The other reason, and probably one that resonates for a lot of people listening to this, is just that you might be a bit of a Postgres maxi. We have a bit of a database-centric development workflow in Supabase, and that's one of the ways that we recommend using Postgres. It's not for everyone, quite honestly, but for those who really like SQL and really like the features of Postgres, then using row-level security is a very neat way to develop applications. Okay, so let's go through the ins and outs of using an RLS, using row-level security. It's actually quite basic. So here I have a table called profiles. All I need to do to enable row-level security for this table is call altered table profiles, enable row-level security. This means that anyone trying to access the table will get denied access unless they have a bypass RLS policy. Or you might be a super user, or you can be the table creator. For this reason, actually, I generally recommend that you enable RLS for most tables anyway, and it increases the default security posture of your role creation. You then have to specify bypass RLS, and you have to be a bit more explicit with your security on the database level. So even if you don't plan to write RLS policies, it's generally worth thinking about at least using row-level security, turning it on for all of your tables. That's pretty much it. So let's go through the anatomy of an actual policy. First of all, we're going to call create policy, and then we give the policy a name. I generally like to use a small descriptive name in quotes. You can also use snake case as you typically would for Postgres objects. If you do use a name like I have here, then just know that it has to be relatively short, otherwise it will be truncated. Then from there, you will attach the policy to a particular table. So you just specify the table name and the schema. You will either have a permissive or restrictive policy. I'll go through this in a sec, but by default, all policies are permissive. Then you specify the operation, which can be select, insert, update, delete, or you can have all. I actually don't recommend using all. That is the default if you don't specify this. I really recommend that you create a policy per operation, and I'll get into the reasons why soon. Then the policy, you can attach it to a Postgres role. I also recommend doing this for granularity and sometimes for performance. So you don't have to, but I really enjoy having very granular policies. Then finally, you can either have, you specify the actual clause inside either of a using or a with check. And I'll go through an example where we have both of these to explain it more in depth, but just from a high level, using, I like to think, will check the existing value that is in the database. So I'm going to validate against what is already there. And a with check will check the incoming value specifically for inserts and updates. So if I've got a value that's coming in, I want to check whether they should be allowed to insert this. First of all, we'll just focus on a using clause here for our select. So I will drill into this using clause here. Here I just have a, I'm selecting an auth function. This one actually exists inside Supabase. It's very common. This one's going to return my current user ID, UID, and then I'm going to validate it against the column inside the profiles table user ID. So what would this look like? Stepping through a really, really small example. Yes, and it should always return a true or a false. And if it returns true, then I'm allowed access, false not. So here is my profiles table. I have three rows, user ID 1, 2, and 3, and I am user ID 3. So here I have my statement, and the select clause will actually validate that I am user ID 3. It will return that. And now we're going to assess against each row whether 3 is equal to the user ID. So first row, 3 is not equal to 1. Second row, 3 is not equal to 2. Third row, 3 is equal to 3. It will allow me to select this particular row. Now, I promised that I would show you also how to use these two, using and with check together. This is very common on a update statement. So first of all, we might, I've just copied and pasted exactly the same clause as I had before. But what we want to do is first check whether the user can update their own rows. So that is using the using clause. And then I actually want to also make sure that whatever value they're updating it to is also their own user ID. Otherwise, they might be able to change their own user ID within a particular table. So this is generally the way that you start building your policies. They're very granular and a lot of copying and pasting. There is an important thing to know about policies. You can actually specify two policies for one table. So here I have one policy for a select statement on which will deny access, returning false. And I have another one which will allow access, returning true. So you might ask, well, will these be anded or ored together? The answer is that actually the access will be allowed by default. They will or together. So that there's one caveat to this. If you have a restrictive policy, then they will be anded together. Now, I find this very complicated. So my general recommendation around row-level security is that you try to keep it really simple by creating one policy per operation, per role, and then you put all of the conditions within that one policy. It really doesn't matter too much in terms of Postgres, but it really helps on the mental model for security, trying to make sure that you can focus in on one particular use case and write all of the logic inside that. Okay, so a few do's and don'ts for Postgres row level security. The first do, this one actually took us a few years at Supabase to realize. If you are calling a function inside your RLS policy, then you should try to wrap it in a select statement. You can see I've got a select and I've also got these brackets. The reason why is that on the right-hand side, the auth.uid will be, this function will be assessed for every single row, versus if I put it on the left with a select, then the Postgres planner will actually call that value first and it'll only call it once. So generally try to wrap any function call into with a select statement. Also, as I mentioned, try not to use the default for all. I really recommend keeping your policies as granular as possible. So one per operation, select, insert, update, delete. The other thing is that here is that auth.uid function that we were actually calling, and this is roughly what it looks like inside Supabase. It's going to return the user ID from a JWT. Generally, you want these, as much as possible, you want to write these functions so that they're stable, not volatile, and specifying that they're stable for the Postgres planner. This means that if they are volatile, then they have to be assessed per row in the database, so they'll get called many times. So for performance reasons, if you can make them stable, then they can be assessed once at the start of the query. Then if you are also using these functions, I generally recommend putting them inside a private schema and then creating these functions with a role which has bypass RLS. Then if you create them with that and you have security definer, it will assume the security posture of the person creating the function. If it is security invoker and that role does not have bypass RLS, then actually anything you call within, let's say you're selecting the permissions from a permissions table, it'll also apply the RLS trickling down through each of the function calls. So because we just want to return a, say, data set, we can actually, in this case, use a role which can bypass RLS to return back the data set, and then inside the RLS policy, use the data set to assess a true or false statement. And then finally, I know that I said, I know that I said that you should, you can think of it as an implicit where policy, but for performance, you should always still specify your where statement when you are selecting from a table. I thought it was very cool at the start, actually, that you could just write blanket select statements and that it would only return the data that you had access to. But actually, for performance reasons, you want the where statement because it will cut down the amount of data before applying the RLS rules. So it's very fast if you just have that filter to start with. Then finally, Postgres now has support for RLS in views. The way that this works is, once again, through security invoker versus security definer. So you can now specify views. I think it's from PG 15 and above, with security invoker true. What this means is that if you are a security invoker false, whoever created the view, it'll assume their level of grants. Security invoker true will assume the RLS rules of the role, which is calling the table. So in this case, if my view is actually referencing private profiles, it will apply the RLS rules that we have attached to the profiles table. So generally, I recommend using the statement from actually almost always these days. There are a ton of tips and tricks. I've just covered a few of them, but we have some docs inside the Supabase docs with benchmarks of each one of the things that I've gone over and a few more, and how much performance gains each one of these actually will give you. Finally, I just want to give some shout outs. A lot of this content is derived from Steve who is the maintainer of Postgres and works at Supabase. And also Gary, who did a lot of the performance benchmarking of RLS, and basically a lot of the community around Supabase who have really leaned into RLS. So just a big shout out to them. Finally, if you are looking for a Postgres database, then do check us out and you can launch a new database with database.new.